The Ghislaine Maxwell trial has currently been underway for 11 days. So far, the prosecution has spent time highlighting how Ghislaine Maxwell participated in procuring underage girls for Jeffrey Epstein, but also participated in the abuse. What are some key takeaway moments from the case so far? How did the defense team handle their first day on Thursday? Stay tuned because I'm about to break it all down. Welcome to my channel, or welcome back to my channel. I'm Rachel Ann, and I'm a licensed professional counselor. If you enjoy dining in on all things psychological commentary, learning about the psychology behind certain behaviors, and hearing anti-MLM content, then make sure you subscribe so you don't miss any future videos. A quick disclaimer, this video is not intending to diagnose any of the individuals discussed, only offering my psychological commentary and some speculation. If you need a refresher on who Ghislaine Maxwell is, then I highly recommend watching a recent video on her, which will be right in the description below. Let me first start with what has happened so far in the Ghislaine Maxwell trial. The Ghislaine Maxwell trial has been moving along rather quickly. As a quick reminder, Ghislaine Maxwell is facing overall 6 counts that include conspiracy and enticement of a minor to travel for the purpose of engaging in illegal sexual acts. 1 count is for the transportation of a minor, 1 count for sex trafficking of a minor, but all counts are related to the sexual exploitation and trafficking of underage girls. Ghislaine Maxwell is pleading not guilty to all charges. Across the 2 weeks of prosecution, the prosecution team brought in 4 victims to testify on the stand their experiences with Ghislaine Maxwell. 3 of these individuals used pseudonyms to protect their identity, and 1, Annie Farmer, was the first to come forward and use her full name. Farmer was one of the first alleged victims of Epstein and Ghislaine Maxwell. One of the interesting parts of Annie Farmer's testimony is that she maintained a journal of some of her experiences with Epstein. I'll circle back to this in a little bit and the importance of this particular piece of information. The 3 preceding victims described graphic incidents of abuse of a sexual nature and all alleged that Ghislaine Maxwell was instrumental in providing instructions as well as facilitating their contact with Jeffrey Epstein. The guise to lure these 4 individuals into the life of Jeffrey Epstein and Ghislaine Maxwell was all centered around advancement of education, career, as well as a way for the victims to make money at that time. One of the central concepts in this trial has been grooming. The psychological definition of grooming is essentially slowly building up a relationship with trust while also fostering intimacy and building upon inappropriate behavior so that the final act or acts, plural, of overt sexual abuse can occur. For a perpetrator of abuse, grooming is a central part of the dynamic. Most abusive individuals do not start out with the act of sexual abuse itself. There often must be a level of trust. The perpetrator will sometimes use information about their victim to their advantage, so there is manipulation that is involved. And trust is then misused as the abusive act happens, because it only elicits confusion in the victim. The victim has a very difficult time understanding why this abuse would happen and even second guessing themselves, blaming themselves, or even trying to rationalize abusive behavior. Grooming is done by the perpetrator of abuse to normalize their own abusive behavior. In addition to hearing from 4 victims, a former house manager who was employed at Epstein's home in Palm Beach, Florida, described Ghislaine Maxwell as, quote, the lady of the house, end quote, further stating Ghislaine was with Jeffrey Epstein 95% of the time. Photographs were brought in to show the level of intimacy and closeness of Ghislaine Maxwell and Jeffrey Epstein, dating all the way back to the 1990s. Judge Allison Nathan, who is presiding over this trial, ruled that 2 of the accusers, Annie Farmer and Kate, were at the age of consent during alleged encounters with Epstein. What this means is that any contact with him was not necessarily considered illegal. This was not a good ruling for the prosecution. However, because Annie Farmer and Kate are not the only alleged victims, the prosecution team did not have to drop any of the charges against Ghislaine Maxwell. This is where I just have to add in, it's so evident that abuse of power occurred. even if these young ladies were considered to be at the age of consent during these abusive incidents, it does not mean that they consented for these situations to happen. Circling back to Annie Farmer's testimony, which the prosecution had Farmer testify as one of the last witnesses, which I think was a very powerful move. Annie Farmer is a psychologist and is currently 42 years of age. She shared she was 14 years old when the abuse started. To support her allegations, her boyfriend at the time that the abuse happened was also called to the stand, as well as Farmer's mother. And both individuals supported statements that Annie Farmer had made describing specifics of the abuse. Annie Farmer was vocal and asked the judge to deny any bail for Ghislaine Maxwell after Maxwell's initial arrest in 2020. And Annie Maxwell stated that Ghislaine Maxwell was a psychopath. This to me was interesting and also lends its hand to having credibility because Annie Farmer is a psychologist. And most individuals who are in the mental health field at that capacity have had some knowledge or training on different diagnoses. So to me, this was not just a term willy-nilly thrown out. It was probably how Annie Farmer, if she could, would diagnose Ghislaine Maxwell. My own speculation there. A diagnosis that I would also agree with, and I say that without having ever met Ghislaine, so again, speculation, but this is something that without even knowing Annie Farmer had made this statement, in my other video, I had talked about how Ghislaine Maxwell encompasses many characteristics of antisocial personality disorder, which is the modern clinical term diagnosis for psychopathy. With the prosecution resting its case after bringing forward four very strong survivors, in addition to a few former employees, I do want to get into some of the events from the 11th day of the Maxwell trial, which is when the defense team began presenting their case. The judge rejected a request from Maxwell to have three witnesses anonymously take the stand to testify on her behalf. Apparently, this was an unusual request, and it was denied. Judge Nathan denied this request, making a very important distinction that there is a huge difference between protecting witness testimonies of Ghislaine Maxwell versus protecting identities of alleged victims of sexual abuse. I found this to be quite a fair and well-informed decision of Judge Nathan. A former employee of Maxwell, Kimberly Espinosa, was called to the stand and also described Ghislaine as the, quote, estate manager, end quote, but described her managerial style as demanding but fair. Espinosa also described relationships that a victim had with Ghislaine as, quote, a loving relationship, end quote, almost like a goddaughter relationship. She also denied any incidents that she had witnessed where abuse had occurred. This witness appeared to have been directly called to combat testimonies of the alleged sexual abuse survivors, but her testimony is eerie to me. It demonstrates that Ghislaine most likely participated in grooming victims, which can also come in the form of being motherly or taking on a nurturing role, all meant to posture outwardly that she's caring, while confusing victims and allowing further abuse to occur. The defense team then called an expert on false memories, Elizabeth Loftus, who is a professor at the University of California. Loftus described memories as changeable, fragile, and able to be distorted by external forces. Loftus stated she has spent decades studying how memory works, with an emphasis on false memories. Loftus testified that what happens after an incident can include disinformation. If someone questions the survivor about the abuse and the person questioning has an agenda, then it can combat the validity of the memory. This is often why police interviewers or child protective service employees or even therapists are trained to not ask what's called leading questions that can lead or influence how a person will respond to a question. It can cause a person to respond in a way that was what the interview wanted to hear versus responding with the actual truth of the situation. The prosecution during their cross-examination really tried to paint a picture of Loftus as being in favor of defendants and trials, which in this case would be Ghislaine Maxwell. Loftus has even authored a book entitled Witness for the Defense. I believe this was done to show that Loftus may not be a neutral witness, show her preference to be a witness for the defense, which may discredit her neutrality in this trial. This to me was a good move by the prosecution team in that an expert should be neutral. And in this particular situation, not only did the defense team hire Loftus, but Loftus has literally authored a book on being a witness for the defense. The concept of memories and even a term called hindsight bias is being brought to the forefront in the Ghislaine Maxwell trial, all in an effort, in my opinion, to show that there were either shaky memories of the victims or to flat out just discredit the testimonies of these victims. So what is hindsight bias? Hindsight bias is where someone has a realization or claims after the fact of a situation to have known what was happening in that particular situation. In hindsight bias, some experts believe that there's a human tendency to only remember certain information and then kind of mold it into what is known or what is happening in the present moment. It's almost as if someone is constructing a narrative to fit whatever situation is happening in that present moment. This is where Annie Farmer's journal comes into play. Annie Farmer maintained a journal around the time she was 16 years old, and while on the stand, read aloud from her journal. Defense attorney Laura Menninger attempted to show or suggest that Farmer's memories were constructed when she cross-examined Annie Farmer. Menninger asked Annie Farmer if her journal had assisted her in remembering certain details and emotions, in which Farmer agreed. To me, this is a no-brainer. Of course, a journal would assist in the recollection of memories, just like taking notes during a class assists in the recollection of memories about what was talked about in the class. Anytime something is written down, obviously it is going to assist in the recollection of a memory. But it appears Menninger was setting Annie Farmer up to be experiencing hindsight bias, or trying to point out that she was reconstructing the narrative in her journal to fit the present day situation. In the Ghislaine Maxwell trial, there is a heavy reliance on memories, or the disruption of memories, as these allegations took place many years ago. Elizabeth Loftus is a leading expert when it comes to false memories, so having her testify on the defense's behalf was unfortunately a fairly strong move. I want to share, though, two different sides of memory recollection very quickly. The school of thought I'm about to share appears to be what the defense is trying to show, in that memories have the capability to be malleable and also affected over time. We know that. And the other components here with sexual abuse is that sometimes an individual will almost try to forget the memory of the incident. Sometimes during trauma, the brain can actually, for lack of a better word, just kind of shut down in an effort to self-protect. However, in this particular case, there are too many, in my opinion, witnesses who have come forward stating very similar stories and examples of how grooming occurred and literal incidents of sexual abuse occurred for guilt not to be assumed. The other school of thought on memories is that some research has actually shown that when an emotionally provoking event occurs, the experience of the emotion, whether it be fear, anger, happiness, can assist in improved memory for visual information and other details of the actual event itself. There is research that has been shown that the more emotional impact a memory has, the better the ability a person has to recall the specific details, storing that memory as a long-term memory. This particular part of recollection has most often been my experience in working with individuals who have endured trauma. Overall, there may be certain aspects that are fuzzy, but for the very strong emotionally provoking events that occurred, people can remember very nuanced details of a situation, from what somebody was wearing to the feeling that they were experiencing at the moment of the trauma, and so forth and so on. As the defense continues to move forward, I'll be interested to see how they try to absolve Ghislaine Maxwell. I certainly don't believe that Ghislaine Maxwell is being scapegoated in this situation due to Jeffrey Epstein not being able to be tried, something that her defense has said. Instead, I think she is rightfully being held accountable and has been shown to be an active participant in the abuse that occurred, not to mention Jeffrey Epstein's right-hand person. There is a lot of damning evidence to show how intimately connected Ghislaine Maxwell and Jeffrey Epstein were, in addition to, again, these strong survivors coming forward to share their experiences. Maxwell's lawyers are set to go ahead and rest their case Friday, but this decision will also be affected by whether or not Judge Nathan allows the defense team to call more witnesses. If you enjoyed this video, you may also enjoy the series that I'm doing on Elizabeth Holmes and the Theranos trial. Or to catch more up on Ghislaine Maxwell and who she is and potentially how she came to be, you can also check out the other video I did, which is more of a psychological analysis on her upbringing. As always, I hope you take really good care of yourself and be well.